next on Gallery. Grab your goggles and put in your earplugs because we have found some Oklahoma artists who get loud and messy when they go to work. Tom Zimmer was a logger in New York when he discovered his inner artist through his chainsaw. Now he's an international champ in his field and calls Oklahoma home. Ken Burkemper uses a chainsaw too, but he sends ice chips flying instead of wood chips. He's another acclaimed sculptor with a chainsaw who is a rare commodity in Oklahoma. But for Zimmer, at least, being a rare commodity does not pay dividends, and he finds himself having to justify prices to clients.
If somebody says, well, how long does it take you to carve something? Sometimes I'll tell them, you know, 13 years and 1 hour. Because I just carved that for you in 1 hour, but it took me 13 years to actually be able to do that for you in 1 hour.
If it were up to us, we'd advise against arguing with a man carrying a chainsaw. Now, put on those safety goggles and prepare to appreciate the work of some of the best chainsaw artists in the world.
Partial funding for Gallery is made possible by the Pauline Dwyer Mecklenburg and Robert A. Mecklenburg Jr. Foundation, and Simmons All Spa, and by Jasmine and Melvin Moran. Additional support is provided by the Oklahoma Humanities Council and the National Endowment for the Humanities.
I tend to think of myself as an artist all the way around. It's just the medium of tool and wood, you know, medium that I'm choosing to use and tools I'm choosing to carve with. Well, I don't think you associate art with a chainsaw. You just, it's not two things that are associated. It's a rustic, crude form of cutting wood, not something that you can actually have a finished, nice product with. So I think that's the real interest level that people think about. You know, they're amazed that you can do that with a chainsaw.
The creations of chainsaw artist Tom Zimmer, a logger and native New Yorker who discovered a latent artistic gift when he was working in the forested middle of nowhere.
Originally, I'm from central New York, and I grew up there in an agricultural community and logging. I had my own logging business and firewood business, so the chainsaw come natural to me. Well, basically we gotta fit this into that, so if you walk away or walk forward, you just walk till this fits into the piece of wood that I'm trying to carve. So I've got about a 5 foot tree that I'm gonna have to top that off at 5 foot to get that to fit in. We're country people. I worked for several different companies before I took on my own logging company. We did that for probably 10 years. And my mother had bought me a videotape of chainsaw carving. And that was just a little side hobby I started doing when I was logging. I'd leave chairs out in the woods, or I'd carve faces in trees for people to stumble on, and the chairs for hunters. It was one job that we actually, me and a guy I had hired for me, we went several hours away from home, so we had to set up a logging camp, more or less. And I carved all the furniture for the logging camp. And before we pulled out, somebody pulled in and bought a whole dump truck load of furniture. So that was kind of my first thought was, wow, I could actually maybe sell this stuff. We got to get a good size cedar log, is what you're looking for.
You're going to have to look, see how much ring you got. I don't know.
And you didn't care if it was cedar or pine or what it was. Then I decided to sell my logging business and go into chainsaw carving as long as I could, as long as it was feasible and we could afford to do it. Originally, I kind of made a little agreement with God, I guess I could say, that I said, give me a couple years to get good at this and I'll get a real job.
It was that real job that landed Zimmer in Oklahoma. After a few years of carving with a chainsaw, Zimmer says he was burned out, so he took a job with a trucking company that gave him a choice of relocating to one of five different cities.
We chose Oklahoma because the two top reasons in all the other cities was crime and drugs. In Oklahoma said heat and tornadoes. And we were moving here with a teenage son, so we said, well, crime and drugs or heat and tornadoes, you know, I guess we'll go with the heat and tornadoes.
There's an old saying, you can take the boy out of the country, but you can't take the country out of the boy. In Tom's case, we'll change that a little. You can take the man out of chainsaw carving country, but you can't take the chainsaw artist out of the man.
In the time that I was down here, I actually started picking up carving. It followed me, I guess, through the internet or through media or whatever. People actually started finding me in Oklahoma. And it slowly started picking up as a sideline job. After I got laid off the first job, I went to work for another trucking company. And the carving had picked up to a rate that I actually thought I probably could go ahead and try this full time in Oklahoma.
In January of 2010, that's just what Zimmer did. He and his wife, Wendy, dedicated themselves to their new business called Oklahoma Chainsaw Carvings full time, an art form not as common in Oklahoma as it is in the Northeast.
I'm going to cut this in half so I can set up a plank, mini scaffolding around this. There's definitely less carvers in Oklahoma. I know there are. I know of several carvers across the whole state, where in New York I might have known of 40 or 50 carvers. So it's definitely less carvers. The wood's harder to get. There's not as big of trees. The types of wood are harder to work with. It's definitely harder to be a carver in Oklahoma than in New York, where I was from.
Tom was used to displaying his work at festivals in New York, so that's what he did here. But his biggest exhibition in Oklahoma happened in September of 2010 at the Oktoberfest celebration in Choctaw, when festival organizer Mike Turek asked Tom to carve a life-size German man that could be displayed in Mike's Old Germany restaurant.
And I said, you know, that would be kind of a neat thing to do for people to see how one of these is created. And it rained on Wednesday of Oktoberfest, but then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, in those 3 days, he created the Fritz figure, which is about 6 foot tall, out of a piece of white oak that he found by the North Canadian River, which it's so neat to know that this is a local piece of wood. And the grain on it was spectacular.
I'm on the internet looking up, trying to research the actual attire, and I remembered Mike was wearing his full outfit. So I called Mike up and said, are you still dressed in your garb? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, you mind if I take some pictures of you?
I didn't know he was going to end up trying to recreate an image of me, which I thought, okay, my friends are going to go, oh, that's what you need? You need a statue that looks like you?
I don't know if he was embarrassed or whatever, but he said he didn't want to have it look like he hired me to carve a statue of him. But it just worked out that way, that he was a best study model for me.
It looks great. I mean, this is now becoming a fixture at Old Germany. And it's something that's that massive of a wooden cutout that people stop and they do a double take and they go, wow, they've never seen anything like that.
It seemed like it wasn't that hard and like anybody could do it. So I didn't really consider myself an artist until I started realizing that it isn't something that everybody can do. It's a gift, you know. Everybody has a different gift, and mine is being able to see three-dimensional. If you can imagine a carving and having a wire fence around it so you could see through it, have a round tubular piece of fence going over an object, that would give you an idea what you're starting with, and you got to remove everything that isn't there. basically. You get the side profile and a front profile, and you start by squaring stuff out, and then you go to rounding it and making it come to life.
You'd think that because his artwork is more unique in Oklahoma, it would be better valued, but Zimmer says that's not the case.
Not a lot of people put art with such a tool as a chainsaw, you know, but the more carvers there are, it generally brings a more of an awareness of how good you are, so they compare prices or quality, or when there's nobody else to compare it with, it's kind of hard to set a price or have people have an idea of an opinion of what you do.
Zimmer carved these three squirrels playing with an acorn in a client's backyard in one day. One long, grueling day that demanded much of his body, his mind, and his talent.
I think a lot of people like to put a dollar amount per hour, like whatever they make at a job. They make 15, 20 bucks an hour. They want to say, well, you took 5 hours, so that should be $100, you know. They're missing the time it took to get good at it.
Tom Zimmer is good at it, as he so modestly puts it. He's so good that he was a force to be reckoned with at national and international chainsaw carving competitions.
I used to do a lot of competitions. We were in a competition series where there was a competition about once a month we could go to, and they're all time orientated. So me and several other guys would be all set to a time clock, and you start out all at the same time, and you go after it, and a lot of it is a 6 or 8 hour competition, so whatever you can get done in that time period is judged on 360 degree point interest, proportion, finish. You know, there's usually 5 or 6 different criterias to the competition. I did quite well. I probably competed for maybe 6 or 7 years, and most of the time I was in the top 3. I did some really neat competitions. It was an international competition. I placed first in that one.
This mild-mannered artist with a chainsaw, make that at least 4 chainsaws, tries to remember that Oklahomans are not familiar with his art form and so can discount its value. But even mild-mannered Tom has his limits.
I'm usually pretty patient and calm with people, but there was an instance not too long ago that I told a lady that she could just get a saw and get some wood and go ahead and try it, you know. And I think a lot of times people are, they want it, they just don't want to pay the price for it. If somebody says, well, how long does it take you to carve something? Sometimes I'll tell them, you know, 13 years and 1 hour. Because I just carved that for you in 1 hour, but it took me 13 years to actually be able to do that for you in 1 hour. You know, and that's what they're missing.
I think that he's an artist, and to be able to visualize what he's creating out of just a raw piece of wood is amazing. To get the three-dimensional effect the way he does, it's just spectacular.
Mike Turek is so pleased with Tom's work that he has hired Tom to do another carving during Choctaw's 2011 Oktoberfest celebration, a female companion for old Fritz here. In the meantime, Tom Zimmer continues to saw away at his artwork to make it more respected in Oklahoma, his new home that he says his entire family has grown to love, despite all that heat and all those tornadoes.
Chainsaw carving's huge. It's across the whole world. There's a lot of carvers, and it's a growing art. It's really growing big. I think you're going to see more of it in Oklahoma.
New York's loss is Oklahoma's gain. It's no brag, just fact. We are home to Tom Zimmer, one of the best chainsaw artists in the world.
My name is Ken Burkemper. I'm the owner and operator of Ideas in Ice. I do primarily all the sculpting right now. We have been in business for 21 years as an ice sculpting company. I have been sculpting ice for 25 years. Our primary function is to provide an ice sculpture for your event, large or small. We can do giant ice sculptures, we can do miniature ice sculptures. just what the name says. We take your ideas and we put them into ice. First off, I believe it's very important to be consistent, okay? We've done most sea creatures you can think of. We do turtles, fish, swordfish, dolphins, crawfish. I mean, all kinds of sea themes that way. Angels, people, places, trucks. I do a lot of different Hindu gods for the Indian community. I do a lot of, for the Native American community, we have several Indian things we do that way. It's limitless. Well, as far as my career choice, I've been a chef for about 35 years. I did ice carving as a chef, along with all different types of food, garmage and cheese carving, chocolate carving, vegetable carving, different things like that when I was a chef. From that point, it just kind of grew and grew and grew, and we pretty much developed the market in Oklahoma for ice carving. And since that point, ice carving has really flourished and become an industry as much as just, you know, a lot of people might think it's a hobby kind of a thing, but it's really not. It's a full-fledged, you know, we're big business. I'm learning something every day. I mean, anybody who says that they know it all, they're just a fool. Because if you're not learning something every day of your life and how to do something a little bit better or a little bit different or a little bit more creative, then your mind is closed and you're just not learning anymore. As an artist, there is a big part of it is artistic. In the very past, I used to think, oh, I can teach anybody how to carve ice. I was teaching a lot of students at different Votex, different places around this city. And I've come to realize that, yes, I can teach anybody how to carve ice, but only a few of them can actually sculpt it. We're doing an ice carving demonstration for the Stuco people here at UConn High School. They're having a big Stuco convention, and I'm gonna do an ice carving for them, and we're gonna then take the ice carving and use it Sunday for their convention when they end.
What are you making for them?
A big cruise ship. We're gonna do the Titanic. My name is Ken Burkemper, and if you have trouble pronouncing my name, just remember I do ice sculptures, and you can say Burkemper. How much does it weigh? This piece of ice is approximately 300 pounds. It's about 60 gallons of water, just a little bit, probably a little bit less than 60 gallons of water, and it weighs almost 300 pounds.
A lot of them had never seen a piece of ice that big. They start to learn about some different things. I try to throw a lot of education in with a lot of fun.
All right, we're gonna have fun. It's a chainsaw!
I really enjoy doing a live demonstration like that. I really enjoy doing a ice festival. I do a lot of ice festivals around where I have a crowd around and we're having fun with the ice carving and you get to interact with the people. For example, some of the things, I start to show them tools and I'll start to explain a couple tools. It's like, yeah, okay, tools, yeah, okay, we're starting to get bored. It's like, oh, look at this one. And I shoot snow across the crowd and it's like, whoa! You know, they all wake up. So, you know, that's lots of fun. And in a demonstration situation like that, we can have a lot of fun along with a learning experience. I teach them a little bit about geometry and a little bit about engineering and proportion and symmetry, all with a lot of fun and the techniques of how to carve ice. At this point, if I look back in my life and I say, okay, here I am, I'm 17, what am I gonna do with my life? It's like I have no concept at all that I'm gonna be an ice sculptor. I mean, that is the furthest thing from my mind when I was younger.
All right,
right, so we're getting there. Different levels, different shapes. We're gonna make a bow.
I grew up wanting to do auto mechanics, wanting to do auto body, wanting to do engineering, wanting to do that type of construction. I'm good with my hands like that. And that's the direction I assumed I probably would go. I mean, when you're young, you can have a direction, but you have to leave the doors open. You know, you can't just shut the door and say, I'm gonna only do this and just focus that way.
Today we're gonna do two angels. Both angels are kind of like they're soaring off a little bit, but their hands are gonna be up and out, and they're gonna be connected at the hand, and then I'm gonna put a bowl in their hands, and then the florist will then put flowers in this bowl.
Well, we call it a vanishing art, actually. We've come to that conclusion a long time ago. Really, as a chef, nothing that I've done in my life has lasted more than one night. And the purpose for what I'm doing is for the enjoyment of my customer. And that's why I'm here. I'm here to service my customer. I'm here to provide that product in the early days as a chef, that food product for them to enjoy. And at the end of the night, it was gone. And in this case, it happens to be ice. That food product is just, I've specialized. I've gone from being, I guess, a general practitioner to being a brain surgeon, you know? That one individual thing.
Had to be a little rougher than I thought.
But it really doesn't bother me. I mean, in some ways, you wish that, you know, your art would last forever. But if it did, then they wouldn't have to keep buying it. So it's kind of a built-in income there, I guess.
From this point, I'll cut a little groove in them to give it some definition. But I'll leave most of those wings all attached. It gives it some strength. It gives it some stability. It's going to give it some longevity. Where if I might be doing this as a competition piece, I'd cut all the way through there and I'd give the wings a little bit more width and a little bit more detail that way. It is melting. It was taken out of about a 15 degree freezer. At 15 degrees, it is 15 degrees, so it has to come up to temperature to start melting. So it's changing as we go and it's gonna change some more in some drastic ways.
Well, I think it turned out wonderful. It went together well. It all set on the table well. It's a beautiful piece. I think they're going to really enjoy it. Okay, here we go. Time to set up the big angels. I get all kinds of responses from people when I walk in a door, especially when I walk in a door. They see the ice sculpture and it's like ooh and ah and everything. You set it on the table. A lot of times, I'm so used to it myself, I'll be setting an ice sculpture up and things will look like they're falling or teetering or tottering and people are going, ooh, they're gonna fall. And it's like, no, I'm just got a hold of it. So, you know, some people are scared of it, but I'm used to it. You got a tall flat cart or what do you got? Just, yeah, keep that to that side, yeah, because as I get in, I don't want to hit it, okay? Okay, bring her together. Well, lighting is very important because the ice itself is a catch-all for light. You set it in a room and there's a lot of light around, it's going to pick up all that light. It's going to prism out. It's going to show colors. It's going to show all that. You get a sense of depth because of that. You look at me and I have a red shirt on and I have a flesh colored neck and you can see that depth and that perception because of it. Well, in ice you don't see any of that. You should go right through it. It's a piece of glass.
That'll freeze those two together there.
At least we hope it is. We want it to be nice and clear and pretty and pristine. And so to get that kind of depth, it's very important to then try to layer your ice sculpture so that those pieces stick out. And then if you can light it properly, the light will pick up on those. it's kind of like a fiber optic thing, where fiber optics, you don't see the light going through the fiber optic, only at the end of the cable. So, you know, lights like that. So it's kind of interesting to light up an ice sculpture. Well, we're growing. We're going to continue to grow. There's going to be some point where I physically can't do it anymore. It is a physical business. I'm going to have to relinquish my empire to someone with a little bit more physical, a little younger, that can physically handle it. Teaching would really be nice. You know, at some point, like I said, I really enjoy teaching and sharing my knowledge and experience. And so that would be a good goal.
For more information on any of our stories, go to the gallery page on our OETA website or send us an email at gallery@oeta.tv.
Partial funding for Gallery is made possible by the Pauline Dwyer Mecklenburg and Robert A. Mecklenburg Jr. Foundation and Simmons All Spa, and by Jasmine and Melvin Moran. Additional support is provided by the Oklahoma Humanities Council and the National Endowment for the Humanities. For a DVD copy of this program, please send a check or money order for $22.95 to the OETA Foundation, Post Office Box 14190, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma 73113. Or to place a credit card order, call 800-879-6382 during regular business hours.